Good evening. I'm Ruby Saunders, and this is the Coalition for Mutual Respect's weekly show that brings to you interesting people, colorful people, and people that you really want to hear about because they have something important to say. This evening, our guest is former Congressman Joseph DioGuardi.
Yes, that's right.
Welcome.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
When you were...
Nice to be back in my old hometown, New Rochelle.
I think a lot of people out there recognize you as a New Rochellian. When you were a congressman, what area did you represent?
Well, when I was a congressman, we were dealing with a district that was different than the one we have now. As you know, every 10 years, because of the population changes, we have the redistricting, and in fact, that's going to affect New York State this year, because I'm told that because other parts of the country have grown more than we have, we're going to lose another two members of Congress. That's really not good for New York.
No, it isn't.
So, but when I was a congressman, it was the 20th congressional district, and it was the lower part of Westchester County, including Mount Vernon, New Rochelle, Yonkers. It didn't include Greenberg. That's still Ben Gilman's district. But it went up the Long Island Sound up until Portchester, so it included Mamaroneck, White Plains. The northernmost town was Ossining and Chappaqua. And in fact, I today live in Ossining, so you might say I never moved out of my congressional district, although I moved out of New Rochelle. It's a beautiful county, by the way.
It is indeed. It is indeed. And we'll forgive you for moving out of New Rochelle. We won't hold it against you.
Well, you know, when the kids grow up and the house gets too big, you have to give it to others who need that kind of space.
Of course.
Shirley and I have a wonderful condominium, kind of a townhouse, on the Hudson River. And it just brings home how beautiful this county is when you look at those great bodies of water, the Hudson and then the Long Island Sound.
Yeah. You have always been concerned about human rights. What has drawn you to the conflict in the Balkans?
Well, when I was a congressman, the issue that came to me first on human rights, because of the makeup of the district, was the issue of Soviet Jewry. As you know, we have a lot of Jewish brothers and sisters that live in the 20th Congressional in those days, Scarsdale, Mamaroneck, you know, to be specific, and New Rochelle. In those days, every rabbi wanted me to come for a breakfast at the synagogue, and we would talk about the issue. So when I went to Congress at that time, I talked to my good friend Ben Gilman, and Ben said, yes, this is something that we have to talk about because Westchester is very concerned about it. And we kind of caucused the congressman from Westchester County, Ben Gilman, in those days Mario Biaggi, Hamilton Fish, and myself. And we had another great Jewish-American congressman, Tom Lantos, who was someone who escaped the Holocaust. He formed the Congressional Human Rights Caucus. So early on, I became a member of that caucus and then later became an executive member. And I was brought quickly into the issues of Soviet Jewry, the issue of the apartheid in South Africa. As you know, we have a lot of interest in this district in those days on that as well. And the issue that was favorite to Tom Lantos was the monks in Tibet, the Tibetan monks in China. But it wasn't 6 months into my role as a congressman that people found out that my father was an ethnic Albanian born in Italy, coming here in 1929, and some Albanians heard him by accident speaking Albanian. And then I realized that we had other human rights problems dealing with the Albanian people in the Balkans, and most people now know today what happened in Kosovo. So you might say that one of the first interests that I had as a congressman with all these issues and with constituents that were concerned about them were the issues of human rights. Now, in those days, it was difficult to get a so-called Republican congressman to spend a lot of time on that. But I think because of the nature of the district, because of the activism of the constituents, I quickly saw that this was an area that I had to become immersed in. And then when the Albanian issue came along and I saw the horrors of the lack of human rights, the full dimension of it, then I realized that this was something that had to become an integral part of my role as a congressman until today. I'm a volunteer human rights activist for the Albanian people.
Tell me, to those of us who are not familiar with the Balkan area and the Balkan countries, could you briefly tell me a little bit about the Albanians, the Kosovars, the Macedonians? Who are they?
Well, the Balkans has always been a very difficult place for people to understand, especially Americans, because we don't spend a lot of time in our grammar schools and high schools studying Eastern European history. And here I was a congressman in 1985 with a pretty good education, having gone to Fordham Prep and Fordham University. And when they started talking about a place called Kosovo, I didn't know that it existed. And here, my father's people came out of this area. They fled the Ottoman Turks into Italy in the year 1488, and I didn't know it. Well, you might say, well, why did my father tell me? Well, you know, they were poor in Italy. They weren't able to go to high school. My dad had a fourth grade education. So what they knew is what was passed down orally, and basically all I heard from my grandmother, my Albanian grandmother, was that there was some problem with the Turks. Never heard about Serbs, never heard about Kosovo, because that history emerged in the 500 years that they were, you might say, on asylum in the Italian peninsula. I shouldn't say Italy, because Italy wasn't formed until 1861, so it was really the Kingdom of Naples in those days. But today you have a diverse group of people making up the Balkans. If you just look at the former Yugoslavia, it had six republics and two autonomous provinces. Now, let me just lay these names on you, because I know Americans don't, you know, get confused when they hear all of them, but there's one country that was formed after World War I as kind of an accommodation to the Slavic people, because Yugoslavia means south, Yugo is south. South Slavia had six republics, Croatia, Slovenia, Bosnia-Herzegovina, Serbia, Macedonia, and you had Montenegro. That's the six, and the two so-called provinces were really treated like republics, with the Albanian province, 90% Albanian of Kosovo, and the Hungarian province, 50% Hungarian of Vojvodina. So there you have eight areas in one state, different kinds of people, different religions. The problem was that they were not being treated equally. So even though they thought they were solving the problem by putting all these people in one country called Yugoslavia, it became apparent that the communists that took over, certainly, you know, they did take over before World War II, and then we had Tito after World War II, and even though people don't consider him the worst manifestation of communism, because he tried to be a broker between the Warsaw Pact, you know, the Russians and the Polish and us, it was still a communist system, and it didn't allow for freedom of expression. It didn't allow for everyone to have equal opportunity to education. And when he died, what happened was that instead of getting better, it got worse, because as bad as he might have been, he was still someone who understood keeping balance with all these groups, and he allowed at least the Albanians to have their own university and to have their autonomous status as a province, which gave them an equal vote to Serbia in this kind of confederation. So the Albanians weren't too bad under Tito, but when he died, and then Milosevic emerges, an ultra-nationalist, much like Adolf Hitler, then all of a sudden, it's the Albanians that take the brunt of the system, because the Serbs, at least the Serbian communist regime, wanted to blame all of their failings on somebody, just like Hitler blamed everything on the Jews. So now the media, which is controlled by the communist system, makes its full impact, negative impact, on the Albanian people. So you have this tremendous disinformation campaign, and the West is getting this, not knowing it's bad information. So already the Albanian people are starting to get, you know, negative views here. And what happened was, after that, he completely occupies Kosovo, makes it like a Warsaw ghetto, and we now know that we had this war, this NATO war, to save the Albanian people. Now, that's just, I concentrated on the Albanian side, but you can imagine the difficulties we have in the Balkans today, when you have all of these units that have now disintegrated, or at least Yugoslavia has disintegrated, and Slovenia is a separate state, Croatia is a separate state. Serbia is a separate state, but it still claims that it owns Kosovo and Vojvodina. And now you have Montenegro, which is part of this new Yugoslavia, saying, I want my independence. You have Macedonia as a separate state, but there's kind of an apartheid there because the one-third ethnic population of Albanians doesn't have access to education, and they live in a concentrated area. And then you have Albania, which was always a separate state, but half of what it was because they put half the Albanian people in this now failed state called Yugoslavia, and Albania still has a communist system. When you look at all of this, you say, my God, how do we solve these problems? So, I mean, you know, we could go for a show just on that. I wanted to go through that litany just to tell the people how much confusion there is with all of these little nations that have emerged from Yugoslavia.
Different languages, different cultures.
Yes, and different religions. Orthodox Christianity, Roman Catholicism, is Islam, and certainly there's a Jewish population still in Sarajevo and other parts of the Balkans. And how do you broker that? And most people would say, well, we have to live together. But when you've had this kind of oppression, there are always radicals and fringe groups and fundamentalists who want to take center stage if they can to make things their way without the democratic process. And that's why my wife and I are so actively involved, because having been trained in a democracy, having been a congressman, the Albanian people know who I am, they listen to us, and we're going there telling them, hey, the only friend you have is the United States of America. You can't rely on these other countries like Russia and Greece. They have shown that they favored at one point Mr. Milosevic. Now, they may be good people in those countries, but the governments have not been friendly to the Albanian people, but the United States of America has. And I tell them all the time, don't, you know, slap your friend in the face. They're trying to help you. Listen to America. Become democratic. Let's go through these elections. Even if you've been injured by other people, you have to grant minority rights to those people that may be in your country. This is what human rights is all about.
It would be very difficult, I should think, after so many years of all kinds of oppression, political, social, personal, to get these people to work together. But that's the only solution, I think, because if they don't work together and try to solve their problem with guns, all they'll do is annihilate each other.
Absolutely, Ruby. There's no choice, especially since we've seen the horrors of a mini World War II, when we saw what happened in Bosnia, mm-hmm. when 200 people, innocent civilians, were killed. We saw concentration camps, again, that were being covered up by people in our own State Department that had to leave the State Department. We saw ethnic cleansing in Kosovo. We're reading in the paper today that the cover-ups now are coming out. There was a truck they found buried in the water near Belgrade. When they opened it up, it was a freezer of 50 bodies of young kids that were killed. This was from Kosovo during the NATO war. We had to stop that, and that's why the United States stepped in. We had to step in to stop that. But if we don't put the people in the right direction right now with democracy and imbue them with democratic values, you could go back to this craziness, and nobody will win that war. You might have some people that think they're going to get some immediate satisfaction, but in the long term, you'll have a destabilized Balkans, and you'll have a destabilized Europe. And that's why the United States is interested in this area. I know we don't want to put any more troops there, but we cannot withdraw immediately, because if there is a destabilized Europe, or if another war begins in the Balkans and creates a destabilized Europe, then we'll have to put many more troops back there again.
That's very true. The situation is a tinderbox, really, that people have to understand. They have to live together, they have to work together. It's hard for Americans who, regardless of their particular ethnicity, religion, backgrounds, we grew up in a democracy. It may not always work, but it's basically a democracy, and it's hard for us to understand why people in other countries don't understand the benefits of democracy. That
we
it's
take it
really
for granted sometimes.
Yeah. Oh, we do. We do. A lot of the times. A lot of the times. These areas were under communist domination for 50 years or more. What is the after effect of this communist domination?
Well, while the communists were there, the one thing that communists did for this area, because they had total control over everything you did, was they kind of put the lid on nationalism. But once the Berlin Wall came down, and then the people in the South, Central Europe and the Balkans sensed that there had to be changes, even Albania, then communism receded, and people started to regain much of their identity back, and not only individual identity, but national identity. So keeping your own language became an issue. Communists tried to take that away. And what happened was this nationalism created a lot more tension and competition. And when you have competition for things that really are not there, because communism kind of made the Balkans naked. There were no jobs. Resources were not exploited the right way, the mineral resources. The environment was in shambles. So how do you get jobs? Now you have freedom, but how do you feed your family? Under communism, everybody had a job. It was inefficient, but they gave something to everybody just to keep them happy. But what you had was shared poverty. You know, I think it was Lord Acton that said that the difference between capitalism and communism is that, you know, in communism you have shared poverty, and in capitalism you have a situation where, I don't know his exact words, but at least you're trying to give people the chance to compete, and there might be inequality, but at least there's the opportunity to do something. There's no opportunity in communism. So when it left the people in the Balkans with very little. And many of them didn't even have education, because communism could not provide that education. And certain groups were completely disenfranchised from it, like the Albanians, until Mr. Tito in 1974 allowed a university in the capital of Kosovo, Pristina, in order to keep some balance. There was no university that Albanians could go to. So you had a big problem. I would tell you that right now communism is not buried. It may be, as far as we're concerned, dead, but we see the problems in Russia. Mr. Putin is not exactly a full-fledged Democrat. And we see in Albania, there's still a Democrat, there's still a communist, the former communists have come back. And we see indications of this still in the Balkans. And why is that? And we say to ourselves, why would someone want a system that has never worked? And again, we take our system for granted. There are some people who don't know how to compete, and as you said, have never experienced democracy. And the only way they think they can get anything is by becoming part of a party, being loyal to somebody, and then being given something because of that loyalty, not by competing or by working for something.
Also, one is more comfortable with the familiar, even though the familiar may not be very pleasant.
Yes.
To try something new is scary.
It is. But we have to be that role model for the rest of the world, as you said. There's something beautiful about the United States of America that with this great diversity, while we have tensions, and we've had much more tension before than we have now, we've always been able to elect governments democratically, and we've been able to see how these governments stick together. Even with the Civil War, you would think this country would have been torn asunder with hundreds of thousands of people fighting on both sides and dying. And yet here we are. So it seems like people in our system feel that there's hope. They may not have everything they want today, but they have the ability at some point to ask for what they want, and at some point to collectively demand it. That's what our political system's all about. That's why we have freedom of speech, freedom of assembly. That's why we have people who came down to Washington and demonstrated in front of my office when they felt strongly about something. So this system is the role model, I believe, for the rest of the world.
Multi-ethnic or ethnic cleansing. Where do the Albanians fit in?
Well, the Albanians, for the last 50 years, in fact, it's been 100 years. We could have a show, but I would urge the people who are listening today to look at the website of the Albanian American Civic League, and you'll see it written at the end of the show. It's www.aacl.com. For 100 years, there have been hostile Slavic regimes trying to cleanse the lands that they had annexed to Serbia, Montenegro, of the Albanian populations. Today in Turkey, there are 5 million ethnic Albanians. How did they get there? Their villages were burned after World War I and World War II in Western Macedonia, and they were forced there. And it became kind of a religious thing. The Orthodox Slavs were chasing these so-called Muslim Albanians back into Turkey. I mean, that was their reasoning. But they literally did it by ethnic cleansing. Now, the worst manifestation was what we saw in Kosovo. Can you imagine Slobodan Milosevic, now an indicted war criminal, hopefully soon to be delivered to The Hague, thought he could get away with pushing out 1 million people from this province, saying that this was the ancient Jerusalem of the Serbian people, which was a lie. They came there in the 7th century. Not that history is going to decide this. The Albanians were there for 10,000 years. They were the descendants of the Illyrian people. Illyria was part of the Roman Empire, Illyricum. Mm-hmm. But the issue was that he thought he could literally, because we were waffling, because we had new Neville Chamberlains today who said, you know, we have peace, let's bring Mr. Milosevic to the table at Dayton, and he doesn't want the Albanians there, so leave them away. Just like Hitler said, don't bring any Jews to any table. This is exactly what happened to us in the last few years at the Dayton Accords, 1995. And we again emboldened this dictator who had just killed 200,000 people in Bosnia, and he thinks he's got the green light to go in now and do his final injustice, which was to ethnically cleanse all the Albanians and to bring and to recolonize with Slavs. So I would tell you that the days of Milosevic are over, that ethnic cleansing should be over, because now the world is watching. We didn't know this before, we now know it. And multi-ethnic states, and there are many of them in the Balkans, including Macedonia, which has a heavy ethnic population of Albanians, they must share resources, they must share jobs, they must have access to education, they must allow a large ethnic group to even have access to training in their tongue. But also the tongue of the country should be used too. And these are the challenges I think we face, and multi-ethnicity is the only way that these governments will survive, by understanding that they have to share the political responsibility, the economic responsibility, and the social responsibility with all the groups.
What role is the U.S. to play, and is this not a European problem?
Well, we would say now that since we bore the brunt of the cost of that war, the NATO war, and we did the right thing, I believe, then, that this really is now a problem that Europe should assume as theirs. Not that we can completely withdraw, because if you look at our vital interests, Europe is in the vital interest, stability there, for the United States. We had President Bush coming in on a platform that said, if you elect me, I will take the troops back. But he realized, and Colin Powell realized, that if we did that, the place would collapse, because you still need peacekeepers, you still need people that are monitoring what's going on, and we now have 15% of the total troops deployed are American. That's about 6,000, way down from where it was. Yes, I believe that we should look to Europe now to take the brunt of what is needed to make the Balkans stable, but we cannot withdraw from it. But at least they got the message that we've put a cap of 15% on the money and the troops that we're going to provide there right now.
Have you seen any movement among European nations to step in and help?
Yes, a lot. The European Union has contributed a huge amount of money to just the budget for Kosovo is now 2 billion marks, and 80% of that is coming from the European Union.
Good.
So I think that they got the message from the Bush administration that they have to step in. Clinton said this too after the war, and that's happening right now.
So there is a light at the end of the tunnel.
Absolutely.
We just hope it isn't a train coming toward us.
Well, that's now remains to be seen, because now elections are coming up in Kosovo, and we have elections coming up in January in Macedonia, and we're fully engaged in making sure that these elections take place in a very democratic way on the Western standards, so they're not manipulated, so that the people can have their own representatives in these areas. That's the ultimate test of democracy. Do we have people that truly represent us? And we hope that the Kosovars are going to be able to do that, and that may put them on the road then to an independent state.
Well, thank you very much, Joe, for sharing your knowledge and your deep concern and your passion for the situation. It's been extremely informative, and I think a lot of us learned a lot that we didn't know before. The Balkans are someplace over there. Often people aren't quite sure where they are, where it actually is, and this makes it clearer, and what all the strife is about clearer. And I'm sure that there are people who would want to help, individuals who would want to help in this, in your endeavor, and you're to be congratulated for taking this on, because for evil to succeed, good men have to do nothing.
I think Edmund Burke said that. Yes,
yes,
you're right.
And obviously, you're a good man who does something.
What did Martin Luther King say? If there's injustice anywhere, then justice is threatened everywhere.
Yes, and we are pleased that there are people like you and your wife who don't stand idly by, but put on the gloves and come out swinging when the cause is just. And
we're not alone in Westchester County. There are a lot of people who
are doing
that.
I'm sure there are.
Great.
I'm sure there are. But there has to be someone to start it. There has to be someone to lead it. There has to be someone to let people know that there are injustices, and let's get together and see what we can do to bring justice to places that have no justice. Well, thank you again. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
My pleasure.
And hope to see you soon again.
Thanks for having me.
Good luck.